5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Reusable rockets, self-driving cars, and 3D printers all sound unrelated. Watch as we share the stories of these three rapidly changing technologies and a sci-fi future they could bring that is right on our doorstep. The origins of rocketry lie in ancient Greece. Hero of Alexandria, a mathematician and engineer, designed a device called the Hero Engine in the 1st century AD. The Hero Engine generated torque by boiling water to generate steam. The steam escaped via two opposing nozzles, forcing the container to spin. It is unclear when the first true rockets appeared. However, their origins have been linked to the Chinese and their discovery of a simple form of gunpowder. The first recorded use of rockets in combat was in the year 1232. The Chinese were able to repel Mongol invaders by using a barrage of crude fire arrows. After this battle, the Mongols went on to construct their own rockets, and may have been responsible for introducing this technology to the West. During the late 17th century, Sir Isaac Newton developed his three laws of motion, and set the stage for modern rocketry by providing the mathematical tools needed by engineers. In 1898, Konstantin Tsiolkovsky suggested that rockets be used to explore space. He also suggested that rockets use liquid propellants rather than solid to increase their range. Due to his research and ingenuity, Konstantin has been called the father of modern rocketry. In the early 20th century, Robert Goddard experimented with rocketry. His focus was on achieving extreme altitudes. He designed the first successful liquid-fueled rocket, and on March 16, 1926, his design took flight. It flew for less than 3 seconds, climbed to an altitude of 41 feet, and landed 180 feet away in a nearby cabbage patch. By today's standards, the flight was unimpressive, but like the first flight of the Wright brothers, he opened the door to a new era of rocket science. In October of 1959, the Soviet Union launched the first satellite, called Sputnik, into low Earth orbit. This ushered in the era of the space race between America and the Soviet Union. The culmination of this race occurred in 1969 when NASA's Saturn V rocket helped Neil Armstrong take his first steps onto the lunar surface. Moving forward to 1981, NASA launched its first space shuttle mission with a reusable spacecraft. From 1981 to 2011, a total of 135 shuttle missions were flown, but we never returned to the moon. The last shuttle flight, made by Atlantis, occurred in July of 2011. To achieve orbit, rockets use a technique called staging. The Minuteman III ICBM, like many modern rockets, uses serial staging to launch a payload into space. Rocket engines are stacked one on top of the other. Once the fuel has been consumed, that stage and its engine are jettisoned, and the next stage ignited. This allows the rocket to reduce its mass and continue on its journey upward to space.
We are able to launch lots of objects into the vicinity of Earth, what we call low Earth orbit. But the goal is points beyond. That transportation has not been fully developed.
Rocket propulsion today is remarkably inefficient. It works, but just barely.
And that is our game. That's where we play. What we're trying to build at Astra is a transformation engine that will redefine the way we travel in space, to make space transportation easy, affordable, fast, and economically rewarding. Space becomes then a place of business, you know, a place of work. People don't necessarily just go to explore.
It's a slow, expensive, cumbersome proposition to explore space with the technology we have today.
And so we have to change that. Every ounce of fuel has to count for more. And that means the exhaust temperature has to be very high. The exhaust of a rocket is a few thousand degrees. We want it to be like the sun, 1 million degrees or 2 million. No chemical reaction can do that. So we don't do chemistry. We use electricity. We go from gas to plasma.
Pulse.
There's something exotic about working with plasma, working with something that is millions of degrees.
The limit is that if you make it too hot, the rocket will melt. We choose not to be limited by metals or materials. Our pipe through which this exhaust goes is really a magnetic pipe, an invisible force. We have eliminated the most fundamental limitation in rocket propulsion, which is how hot you can make the exhaust.
We inject a propellant, a neutral gas, into an ionization chamber. We launch radio waves at it. Those radio waves convert that gas into a cold plasma. This plasma then proceeds into the booster section, the ion cyclotron resonance.
The next step would be to put electrical energy in to superheat the gas in a plasma state and accelerate it to the velocities needed for space travel.
Ultimately, our rocket can go further and faster than any other rocket that exists today.
And the rocket might be, similar size to what you would have for the chemical rocket, but now the propellant that you need is only this much.
The more cargo that you can carry for a given amount of ship, the more efficient your exploration program is going to be.
Space transportation will be part of our daily lives, and it has to be safe and affordable, and that's the next horizon.
Bessemer is one of those possibilities that will allow us to fundamentally transform space travel.
Most fuel-efficient, cost-effective way, which is a big business opportunity. The Bessemer engine can be the diesel engine of space.
And that is the promise of the technology, to make the ability to stay operating in space cheaper and much more sustainable than it is today.
Bessemer is one of the most interesting space propulsion concepts that I have ever seen.
Ad Astra and Franklin Chang Diaz and his team is making history. The Bessemer engine and the plans for its development are revolutionary.
I feel like I'm at the first step of Star Trek, creating the warp drive that's going to take people and future generations to great distances.
Bessemer will be a game changer. Space is very, very large, so we have a lot of work ahead of us, but really is nothing but ensuring our survival. That's what we're doing.
On December 21st, 2015, SpaceX, a private company founded by Elon Musk, made history. Their Falcon 9 rocket was able to successfully achieve a low Earth orbit, release several satellites, and then return to Earth and land upright.
BC, start the launch auto sequence.
In order.
Prop, confirm you're ready for engine chill in 30 seconds.
Prop is ready for engine chill.
The spacecraft are on internal power.
Stage 1 locks, stage 1 fuel, stage 2 fill rates all nominal.
All stations verify, ready for launch, all stations acknowledge. FTS.
FTS go.
Prop.
Prop go.
AVI.
AVI's go.
GNC.
GNC go.
OSM.
OSM go.
Recovery.
Landings go. LC, LD, go for launch.
T-minus 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. liftoff of the Falcon 9.
Since the beginning of the invention of the car in 1886, people have imagined a vehicle that can take them wherever they want to go and allow them to do other activities as they travel. The technological evolution of self-driving vehicles has been mostly conceptual up until the 1960s. Slowly, the process of satellite technologies such as GPS, electronic computers, and optical sensing equipment created avenues for the development of autonomous vehicles. The final goal of freedom from the drudgery of driving on the road is within our reach, and autonomous vehicles in the future will provide a safe, mobile extension of our personal living space.
OnStar will now disengage automatic drive. Are you ready?
Yes! Imagine being the perfect driver. You never got drowsy, you never took your eyes off the road, you could see 360 degrees around you, and you never got drunk. That's the promise of driverless car technology, and it's closer than you think. We weren't always that close. We've been talking about driverless cars since the 1930s, and back then everyone thought we'd definitely be in driverless cars by the 1960s.
Safe distance between cars is maintained by automatic radio control. In the world of tomorrow.
Well done, Firebird 2. You're now under automatic control. Hands off steering.
Well, we missed that window by a good 40 or 50 years. But today, we're closer than we've ever been before.
Here we go, guys.
The fuse was really lit by DARPA in 2004 with the DARPA Grand Car Challenge. It was a contest to find technology that the military could use for driverless vehicles. It was a race through the desert at top speed without crashing, and guess what? In 2004, there were no winners.
Okay, we have a bot on its side.
It wasn't until 2005 the DARPA Grand Car Challenge again through the desert as quickly as possible without crashing. There was a first place winner.
I saw the concept first in the DARPA Grand Challenges. So we decided at Stanford to build a different self-driving car, and the unimaginable happened. It became the first car to ever return from a DARPA Grand Challenge.
So Google had lured away that guy Sebastian you just saw to work on Google's driverless car technology.
We've driven in cities, mountain roads, day and night, and even Lombard Street in San Francisco. We've driven 140,000 miles. people didn't even notice.
As for how Google's driverless car works, it's a mixture of laser sensors, radar, cameras, and GPS. The real secret sauce, though, is the laser sensor on top of the car, which captures a 360-degree image and millions of data points every second. The reason the laser is so important is that GPS isn't quite reliable enough. GPS can't detect objects in front of you. It can't draw a map around you as you drive like the laser can. You think Google Maps is impressive? Wait till you see the maps that are produced by a bunch of Google driverless cars going around the city. There's also a camera mounted underneath the rearview mirror that leverages image recognition programs to help the car read signs, traffic lights, and other elements in the driving environment. Also to help detect objects are four radars, three mounted on the front of the car, one on the back.
Our sensors spot the orange signs and cones early to alert the car of the lane blockage ahead, and we can change lanes safely.
There's also an ultrasonic sensor called a position estimator that works along with the GPS to help the car's mapping position. So all this imagery is being captured, all this data is being collected, and that's great, but it means nothing without sophisticated software to make sense of it all. That's where you're going to start to see differentiation amongst people like Google and Ford and Audi and all the different car companies. All the hardware is relatively similar for each of these solutions. The software is what's going to make the difference. The thing about driverless cars is they need to be adaptive. What happens if it snows? What happens if it starts raining? What happens if someone darts out in front of the car? These cars need to be able to adjust themselves on the fly.
So now what you'll see is our vehicle at a busy intersection. The red and green fences indicate that the car will stop and wait until the path is clear. We even detect the cyclist approaching from behind and wait until they've passed.
Whether you know it or not, there's already plenty of driverless car technology all around you. You have cars that can parallel park themselves, cars that'll help you stay in your lane, cars that'll warn you if you're about to hit something, cars that'll actually brake for you if you're about to hit something, and then cars that can actually valet park themselves. Take a company like Valeo that's working on cars that park themselves. Picture this, you pull up to Costco, you get out of your car, you go right into the store, and the car goes and finds a parking spot in the parking lot. That's the eventual promise. The technology is still in its early stages, but that's coming in the not too distant future. So what's the future of driverless car technology? Will we ever have fully driverless cars? The answer is yes. It's gonna happen. Just embrace it. You're not gonna have to embrace it for a while though. People wanna drive cars. People don't trust driverless cars yet.
An unmanned car driven by a search engine company. We've seen that movie. It ends with robots harvesting our bodies for energy.
There's a lot of legal issues we gotta get through. The first time there's an accident with one of these driverless cars, it's gonna cause a whole mess. There's gonna be a media firestorm. Politicians are gonna get involved.
Right now, it is against the law for a vehicle to be on the roadway without a human being driving it.
People are gonna be saying, what's to be done about these driverless cars? That's why we're easing into it right now. It may not happen overnight. May not happen in a decade, may not happen in 25 years, but we're off to a good start. We just need to get comfortable with it.
So in 1885, Carl Benz invented the automobile. Later that year, he took it out for the first public test drive, and true story, crashed into a wall. For the last 130 years, we've been working around that least reliable part of the car, the driver. We've made the car stronger, we've added seat belts, we've added airbags, and over the last kind of decade, we've actually started to try and make the car smarter to fix that bug, the driver. And it's a big problem. 1.2 million people are killed on the world's roads every year. In America alone, 33,000 people are killed each year. To put that in perspective, that's the same as a 737 falling out of the sky every working day. It's kind of unbelievable. Cars are sold to us like this, but really, this is what driving's like, right? It's not sunny, it's rainy, and you want to do anything other than drive. And the reason why is this. Traffic is getting worse. In America, between 1990 and 2010, the vehicle miles traveled increased by 38%. We grew by 6% of roads. So it's not in your brains. Traffic really is substantially worse than it was not very long ago. And all of this has a very human cost. So if you take the average commute time in America, which is about 50 minutes, you multiply that by the 120 million workers we have, that turns out to be about 6 billion minutes wasted in commuting every day. Now that's a big number, so let's put it in perspective. You take that 6 billion minutes and you divide it by the average life expectancy of a person, that turns out to be 162 lifetimes spent every day, wasted, just getting from A to B. It's unbelievable. And then there are those of us who don't have the privilege of sitting in traffic. So this is Steve. He's an incredibly capable guy, but he just happens to be blind. And that means instead of a 30-minute drive to work in the morning, it's a 2-hour ordeal of piecing together bits of public transit or asking friends and family for a ride. He doesn't have that same freedom that you and I have to get around. We should do something about that. Let's spend some time talking about how the car sees the world. So this is our vehicle. It starts by understanding where it is in the world by taking a map and its sensor data and aligning the two. And then we layer on top of that what it sees in the moment. And so here, all the purple boxes you can see are other vehicles on the road. And the red thing on the side over there is a cyclist. And up in the distance, if you look really closely, you can see some cones. Then we know where the cars were in the moment, but we have to do better than that. We have to predict what's going to happen. So here, the pickup truck in the top right is about to make a left lane change because the road in front of it is closed. And so it needs to get out of the way. Knowing that one pickup truck is great, but we really need to know what everybody's thinking. So it becomes quite a complicated problem. And then given that, we can figure out how the car should respond in the moment. And so what trajectory it should follow, how quickly it should slow down or speed up. And then that all turns into just following a path, turning the steering wheel left or right, pressing the brake or gas. It's really just two numbers at the end of the day. So how hard can it really be? Back when we started in 2009, this is what our system looked like. So you can see our car in the middle, the other boxes on the road driving down the highway. The car needs to understand where it is and roughly where the other vehicles are. It's really a geometric understanding of the world. Once we started driving on neighborhoods and city streets, the problem becomes a whole new level of difficulty. You see pedestrians crossing in front of us, cars crossing in front of us, going every which way, the traffic lights, crosswalks. It's an incredibly complicated problem by comparison. And then once you have that problem solved, the vehicle has to be able to deal with construction. So here the cones on the left are forcing it to drive to the right. But not just construction in isolation, of course. It has to deal with other people moving through that construction zones as well. And of course, if anyone's breaking the rules, the police are there. And the car has to understand that that flashing light on the top of the car means that it's not just a car, it's actually a police officer. Similarly, the orange box on the side here, it's a school bus. And we have to treat that differently as well. When we're out on the road, other people have expectations. So when a cyclist puts up their arm, it means they're expecting the car to yield to them and make room for them to make a lane change. Now, the way we accomplish this is by sharing data between the vehicles. The first kind of most crude model of this is when one vehicle sees a construction zone, having another know about it so it can be in the correct lane to avoid some of the difficulty. But we actually have much deeper understanding than this. We can take all of the data that the cars have seen over time, the hundreds and thousands of pedestrians, cyclists, and vehicles that have been out there, and understand what they look like, and use that to infer what other vehicles should look like and other pedestrians should look like. And then, even more importantly, we can take from that a model of how we expect them to move through the world. So here the yellow box is a pedestrian crossing in front of us. Here the blue box is a cyclist, and we anticipate they're going to nudge out and around the car to the right. Here there's a cyclist coming down the road, and we know they're going to continue to drive down the shape of the road. Here somebody makes a right turn, and in a moment here, somebody's going to make a U-turn in front of us, and we can anticipate that behavior and respond safely. Now, that's all well and good for things that we've seen, but of course, you encounter lots of things that you haven't seen in the world before. And so, just a couple of months ago, our vehicles were driving through Mountain View, and this is what we encountered. This is a woman in an electric wheelchair chasing a duck in circles on the road. Now, it turns out there is nowhere in the DMV handbook that tells you how to deal with that. But our vehicles were able to encounter that, slow down, and drive safely. Now, we don't have to deal with just ducks. Watch this bird fly across in front of us. The car reacts to that. Here, we're dealing with a cyclist that you would never expect to see anywhere other than Mountain View. And of course, we have to deal with drivers, even the very small ones. Watch to the right as someone jumps out of this truck at us. And now, watch to the left as the car with the green box decides he needs to make a right turn at the last possible moment. And here, we watch a car blow through a red light and yield to it. And similarly here, a cyclist blowing through that light as well. And of course, the vehicle responds safely. And of course, we have people who do I don't know what sometimes on the road, like this guy pulling out between two self-driving cars. You have to ask, what are you thinking? Now, as you can see, we've made some pretty exciting progress. And at this point, we're pretty convinced this technology is going to come to market. We do 3 million miles of testing in our simulators every single day. So you can imagine the experience our vehicles have. We are looking forward to having this technology on the road, and we think the right path is to go through this self-driving rather than driver assistance approach because the urgency is so large. You know, in the time I have given this talk today, 34 people have died on America's roads. How soon can we bring it out? Well, it's hard to say because it's a really complicated problem. But these are my two boys. My oldest son is 11, and that means in 4.5 years, he's going to be able to get his driver's license. My team and I are committed to making sure that doesn't happen. Thank you.
Soon, you may be able to create a kidney with a copy machine.
How would you like to download a coffee table? Or at least a digital model of a coffee table that you could customize any way you like so it fit perfectly in your living room, and then you just print it out. I'm not talking about a picture of a coffee table. I'm talking about an actual, physical, three-dimensional object that lives in your living room. Well, it's all possible. It's the world of 3D printing, and it's going to change everything. It'll redefine the way we think about innovation, design, manufacturing, distribution, everything about buying and selling tangible goods from here to Mars. Simply put, 3D printing is the process of making three-dimensional solid objects out of ones and zeros from a digital file. 3D printers bridge the gap between the digital and physical worlds. It uses very thin layers of plastic measuring just a few microns, as thin as a sheet of copy paper, to build an object from the bottom up. This is additive manufacturing. It creates a new item by adding only what is needed, unlike other forms of manufacturing where the excess is carved, cut, or melted away, leaving a ton of waste.
The history of 3D printing began in the 1980s with Charles Hull, who was experimenting with a UV laser and a UV-sensitive resin. His success with this work led him to patent the first additive manufacturing technology in 1986 called stereolithography. The stereolithography process uses an ultraviolet laser to harden liquid resin at specific points on top of a platform immersed in the resin. An object is built layer by layer from this hardened resin, with the platform being lowered after each layer has been formed. This was just the beginning of what we call 3D printing. Charles Hull went on to found a company called 3D Systems, which today stands as one of the largest players in the additive manufacturing industry. In 1987, selective laser sintering, or SLS, was developed and patented by Dr. Carl Deckard and academic advisor Joe Beeman at the University of Texas in Austin, Texas. Selective laser sintering is mainly used for rapid prototyping or low-volume production of parts. In 1989, fused deposition modeling, or FDM, was developed by Scott Crump, who went on to co-create a company called Stratasys, a major player and one of the largest companies in the additive manufacturing industry. In 1992, the world's first commercially available stereolithography machine was created and sold on the market by Charles Hull, the same man who had patented this technology in 1986. Moving forward to 2005, Dr. Adrian Bauer founded RepRap, an open source initiative to build a 3D printer capable of printing its own parts. The RepRap project made a huge leap by taking 3D printing into the consumer sector. In 2014, the patents for selective laser sintering began to expire, opening up this technology to a wider range of materials and applications. In 2015, there were many advances in 3D technology, such as 3D printed clothing. Anouk Whipwreck's spider dress combined 3D printing and electronics to defend the wearer's personal space. Other advances were 3D printed pills, and even 3D printed brain tissue. The most recent advance in 3D printing technology has been the ability to print with molten glass. Researchers at MIT unveiled in August of 2015 what could be a new 3D printing technology they call 3DGP. 3D printing is making history almost on a daily basis. So where will this technology ultimately end up? Only time will tell.
It may be the most eye-catching development in printing since Gutenberg invented the printing press 600 years ago. A machine that can make copies of almost anything, but this time in 3D. It seems like science fiction, but 3D printing is already in use, building hearing aids, jewelry, even parts for NASA. Now the technology is becoming available to anyone, meaning you can turn your garage into a small factory. So what would you build if you could create anything? From guitars to race cars, even a model of your unborn child, people who embrace 3D printing are finding new uses for the emerging technology. Once used at the industrial level only, 3D printing has gone mainstream. Hod, who calls himself a 3D printing addict, has just co-authored a book on the subject that will be released next week. And the one thing he's betting will spur demand for the technology may surprise you.
I think it will be food. I think food printing is to 3D printing what gaming was for computers.
Already, students at his lab have printed chocolate, peanut butter, even cakes. Beyond food, there are few disciplines Hod thinks 3D printing won't touch. Printing an iPod, he says, isn't that far off. Today, in Manhattan, you can wander into a 3D printing store, the only of its kind, and take home your own printer for $2,200. Bree Pettis is the co-founder of MakerBot.
One of the reasons we opened a retail store is because 3D printing is still science fiction to a lot of people. The idea that you can have a machine and send it a digital design, a 3D model that's virtual, and it'll turn into something real, a physical model, it blows people's minds.
From tools and toys to models and jewelry, MakerBot's printer allows anyone to design and create.
We've put the design in here with the SD card. We press the big red M to get it jumped to life. It heated up, and now it's drawing in plastic.
To some, the printing is still rudimentary and nothing more than a novelty item. Bree sees it as a natural evolution.
Back in 2008, you could download movies, you could download books, you could download music, but you couldn't download things.
MakerBot's printer only works with plastic and can only print items smaller than a shoebox. Still, more than 15,000 have been sold.
Our biggest customers are NASA, GE, and 7 out of the top 10 architecture firms in the US.
What you're watching is an ear being printed. Layer upon layer, tiny droplets are deposited, building up the structure.
So this is someone's ear?
This would be printed to be someone's ear.
Oh my goodness.
The project is a type of 3D printing called bioprinting, led by Dr. Anthony Atala at the Wake Forest Institute for Regenerative Medicine in North Carolina.
Same technology you have at your very own home, but instead of printing sheets of paper with ink, you're actually printing tissues with cells.
The premise is simple. Send a scanned image of a body part to the printer, and the machine starts building. Ears, noses, fingers. Dr. Atala's goal is to transplant the parts directly into patients.
So we're actually testing a lot of these structures right now experimentally. The way it works is the cells are able to anchor onto the scaffold. They start making new tissue, and as that starts to happen, this scaffold goes away.
An ear takes between 4 to 6 hours to make, printed with what's called bio-ink, a mixture of biodegradable gel and actual human cells.
One of the big advantages of these technologies is that you are using the patient's own cells. And by doing so, really, you avoid the major problem of rejection.
Dr. Atala has specialized in regenerative medicine since 1990. But it wasn't until this TED Talk 2 years ago that the promise of building body parts caught fire.
90% of the patients on the transplant list are actually waiting for a kidney. You can actually see the printer back here, and that's been printing this kidney structure that you see here. Here it is. You can actually see that kidney as it was printed earlier today.
Right now, Dr. Atala's bioprinting is in the preclinical phase. Simpler organs will be the first to reach patients, starting with skin.
If this were in fact a wound, it would be dropping real skin cells over the wounded area.
The skin printing project is being funded by the U.S. military with the hope of treating injured soldiers in as little as 5 years.
Inside his MIT lab, Dr. Ali Khadim Husseini is tackling a big problem: the hundreds of thousands of people waiting for an organ transplant.
Many of those people die while waiting, and many of them have to wait for someone else to die to get an organ. So we try to actually address this problem by being able to make artificial tissues using 3D printing technology.
You heard right, and Ali figures within 10 or 20 years he'll have it done. They've already figured out how to 3D print human cells, tissues, and blood vessels. Something like a heart, though, is much more complex. But the building block is this guy.
We made aquatic like creatures that can propel and move themselves in the solution by using human cells. Being able to generate these kinds of beating tissues will help us a lot in trying to actually accomplish something that could be medically relevant.
Yes, that little jellyfish-like being is created, printed to be exact, using human cells that actually emulate a beating heart.
We have one of our printers that we can use to print cells and materials to make things like artificial blood vessels or artificial liver.
It's not just organ transplants he's trying to solve.
One of the other things that we do with 3D printers is we actually try to make artificial tissues that can be used for testing drugs for the whole pharmaceutical industry, or be able to make devices that, let's say, a soldier can use in the battlefield to see if there's a toxic compound present.
To do that, the lab looks at how drugs cause a domino effect as medication moves from, say, the liver to the heart. It's a complex system, one that could potentially eliminate the need for animal testing. Ali calls it organs on a chip.
If you just have liver cells by themselves or heart cells by themselves, you don't see this interaction. But if you have human tissues, human organs that actually have this talking ability with each other in these systems, we actually use the 3D printers to be able to make these miniaturized tissues that enable this organs on a chip systems.
The technology is a game changer for the pharmaceutical industry.
Enable is an online global community of volunteers who are using 3D printers and 3D design software to make prosthetics for children and adults who are missing fingers, hands, and wrists, and we're giving them away for free.
One of the reasons 3D printing is so well suited to this problem is no two cases are exactly the same. Some kids are missing all of their fingers, some are missing even the palm and the wrist. One of the reasons we can produce these devices for in kind of incredibly low cost, well under $100, is these devices are entirely body driven, purely mechanical, so there are no motors, there are no sensors, there are no heavy batteries. So it's a very lightweight, very simple device.
These hands don't even pretend to look like normal hands. They're very different. These things look like something Iron Man or a superhero would have, and the kids love them for that reason.
Once I had this hand, my friends would ask, "Hey dude, how's it going? Like, has like anything changed with it? Is it working better?" And like, it's pretty cool how they're like actually like involved. They're actually like talking to me about it. And like, I love this because like I could pick up stuff and I could help.
It's been really great to have Kieran and his family come to Pier 9, to prototype these new ideas, to test drive these new hands, and to be able to see the higher perspective, what this is all about, to see how that hour of CAD, translated into him being able to hold his coat or zip a zipper better.
What Enable has done is it seems that they've kind of proven that regular people can design amazing things if they're given access to the tools.
I think it's pretty cool that I'm one of the people actually like testing this out for like a bunch of other people. It's going to be really awesome to see it when it's so big, like every kid that has a problem like me will have a hand.
We've come a long way since those Star Trek days of just pretending to build things in space. The reality is that a 3D printer has worked on the space station, and now it's getting us closer to building the tools we need for a journey to Mars.
Back in November of 2014, Maiden Space and NASA Marshall began the first set of prints, and that went down in history as the first thing ever manufactured off planet Earth. It's a very interesting feeling to know that we were part of this big effort to do something that has been talked about for decades. It's been science fiction wrote about manufacturing in space even before NASA started looking at it, and then to be able to come in and just be a part of an effort like that is just amazing.
So how has it worked?
The 3D printers worked very well. So we did a lot of that is a testament to the work that went into it before we launched. So we did a flight opportunities program with NASA to fly the printers in zero gravity on parabolic aircraft flights. So we knew that the technology had a pretty good chance of working. And once we got on station, we started doing a test campaign where we printed a lot of different types of print articles that are now back on the ground, and we're putting them through test and learning about the differences between manufacturing in microgravity compared to Earth.
Yeah, that's what I was going to ask. Is it that much different than 3D printing here on Earth?
So at this point, we have not found any significant differences in the way our printers are performing. All that really means is that we're getting nominal operation out of our machine. So we've designed it to work in microgravity, and the tests are showing that indeed it does work in microgravity.
What are some of the impressive things you've printed?
My favorite thing by far that we've printed is a ratchet. And you can find some really nice images of astronaut Butch Wilmore holding his ratchet on the space station. And that's a part that has multiple parts inside. There's a gear, and it's an actual ratcheting tool. It's rated, torque rated for NASA and everything. That picture was taken 2 hours after we sent the digital file of the tool to the printer. So in 2 hours, we uplinked the instructions to a 3D printer on the space station, printed the tool out, and then Butch is holding it in his hand. And there's absolutely no other way to get something into the space station that quickly. Even if that tool was launched on a rocket at the same time that we sent the digital file, it would have been days later that it would have been unpacked and usable. What we've done is we've demonstrated that in an exploration mission, we can actually use this technology and rely on it. And as we move forward, we'll continue to demonstrate and build confidence. This was obviously a test. It's obviously the beginning of a much bigger picture, so we have a lot of work to do. And when I say we, I mean Maiden Space and NASA together, understanding how this works and building out new tests and really building confidence in the whole process. Really, at the end of the day, it's about building sustainable technologies for human exploration in space.
Bringing rockets, autonomous vehicles, and 3D printing together creates a unique opportunity for us. The idea of a not-too-distant future where our machines travel to the Moon or Mars before we arrive to create our colonies is remarkably possible. However, other worlds are much harsher than our own. Planet Earth is protected by its atmosphere, the layer of air that surrounds it. The ozone layer shields us from powerful solar radiation, keeps the temperature balanced, and protects us from meteoroids. On the Moon's south pole, you can see almost perpetual sunlight on the horizon. This is the site of our lunar base. Conditions on the Moon are very different from that of the Earth. Because the Moon has no atmosphere, there is no protection from solar radiation. There are extreme temperature fluctuations, and there is no protection from gamma radiation from outer space, and no protection from meteoroids. Automatic guidance systems would guide our machines to their destinations, where they would land themselves. Inside the lander is an inflatable dome and two autonomous robot vehicles with 3D printers. The dome membrane would be inflated to act as a scaffolding for the 3D printers. The autonomous robot with its 3D printer has a scoop at one end to collect regolith, the loose rock and dust on the lunar surface, and a supply tank containing an adhesive for printing. At the other end is a robotic arm with a printing head. The robot collects the regolith. Layers of this are built up over the dome to create a protective shell. The 3D printed structure reinforces and binds the regolith together. This process would take about 3 Earth months. The resulting structure is lightweight and very strong. When this lunar dome is complete, it can house up to 4 people. Inside the dome, people are protected from solar radiation, meteorites, gamma radiation, and high temperature fluctuations. The original capsule functions as an airlock and technical support module. The skylights provide natural daylight to the people in the living and workspaces. The future colonists arrive after the lunar dome has been completed. Combining the three technologies of rockets, autonomous vehicles, and 3D printing provides a pioneering advance in space age construction and future colonization of planets and moons in our solar system.
So what?